Welcome to the Holiness Today podcast. This is the fourth session of the Global Theology Conference in Pilar, Argentina. In this session, Rob Fringer, Stanley Bebe, Timothy Gaines, Jacob Lett, Udo Prado, and Mauricio Ricaldo respond to the questions from small groups. This session is moderated by Mesoamerica Regional Education Coordinator, Jorge Baños.
De esta conferencia. Gracias por su presencia, por su tiempo, disponibilidad y puntualidad. Muchas gracias. Vamos a dar inicio. Mi nombre es Jorge Baños, soy el coordinador de educación de la región de Mesoamérica y para mí es un placer ser el moderador en esta tarde de este panel. Ya cada uno de nuestros hermanos fue presentado en la plenaria de la mañana. Y la dinámica es la misma del día de ayer en la tarde. ¿Sí? Muchas gracias a cada uno de los grupos por sus preguntas. Muchísimas gracias. Pero queremos también pedir disculpas. Son 18 grupos y el tiempo no nos da para poder cubrir las 18 preguntas. Entonces, la dinámica, vamos a trabajar con el panel sobre las preguntas que nos han llegado de sus grupos. Ellos van a contestar no en el orden, sino como ellos deseen hacerlo, ¿sí? Tanto ponentes como reactores. Y al terminar la parte de ellos, ese silencio nos va a ayudar para que también el público pueda participar en esa misma pregunta, ¿sí? Si desean ampliar, desean aportar, ¿sí? O preguntar en la misma dirección. Quiero comentarles, en la revisión previa de las preguntas, como que hubo mucho preguntas sobre el quebrantamiento. Entonces, va a ser el tema, hermanos del panel, va a ser el tema, ¿sí?, a conversar mayormente en esta tarde. Gracias a cada uno de ustedes. Y, ¿sí?, quiero leer la primera pregunta. Va a aparecer ahí. ¿Por qué el quebrantamiento es consecuencia del pecado? ¿Puede el grupo definir qué se entiende por quebrantamiento? Prestando mayor atención a la contextualización de este lenguaje. ¿Sí? ¿Por qué el quebrantamiento es consecuencia del pecado? ¿Puede el grupo definir qué se entiende por quebrantamiento? Prestando atención a la contextualización del lenguaje. ¿Sí? ¿Abierta? Aquí está el micrófono. Gracias, Mauricio. ¿Vot?
I'll start. Yes. In terms of the language, I can't quite speak to that other than to try to work together to think through what is appropriate language to describe what we're trying to talk about here. There is a stated positively for a moment, and I think some of this was discussed in groups, the reality of the need for authenticity and vulnerability in community is part of what we're talking about, rather than presenting, you know, the unblemished lamb. We recognize within the community that individually we don't have it all figured out, and we bring our brokenness to how we try to figure out things. We bring our pain and our hurts and even our sin to those as we try to figure that out. And it's a recognition for a need to have these discussions and to think deeper in how we still are lacking in many ways in terms of how we talk about holiness and think about holiness in community. I will just also note there are several examples of and types of brokenness, of imperfections. So this group, no women in this group, is a imperfection. It's a brokenness, and how that happens. And we recognize, and this is not, again, this is always the hard part in vulnerability and openness. It's not hearing the other person as if they're attacking another person. We're trying to put the problem out there and say, how do we as a community begin to address these things honestly, openly, and actually work towards transformation? And so transformation into the image of God is still the goal. Individuals participating in holiness, the community holiness is still the goal. And so it's that openness to have those conversations.
Sí, a mí me gustaría citar a Isaías en sus últimos libros, en sus últimos capítulos del 55 al 66. Hay un texto que dice que el eunuco ni el extranjero puedan decir no son parte del pueblo de Dios. Y Elizabeth H. Mayer escribe un libro que se llama El mensaje de la comunidad en el tercer Isaías. Y ella propone que el tercer Isaías es un grupo de eunucos, hombres que fueron rotos por el reino de Babilonia. Y las metáforas que hay en este tercer Isaías, creo que son metáforas muy significativas a lo que estamos hablando. Porque se habla sobre todo de este Yahvé, que es el alfarero, y la palabra que se ocupa en hebreo para corazones rotos en Isaías es la misma raíz que eunuco. Y entonces vemos a este Dios reparando el corazón de estos hombres rotos, que literalmente están quebrados en sus cuerpos. Y para terminar en este punto, Lucas va a recoger a Isaías en el capítulo precisamente en el que estamos, Lucas 4, va a recoger al tercer Isaías y también lo va a levantar en Hechos cuando está con el etíope. Y el etíope tiene varias características: uno, es extranjero; dos, es eunuco; y tres, es africano. Y entonces, y lo que está buscando el tercer, este personaje en Hechos, es precisamente que Lucas nos va a decir el Evangelio también es para ellos. Y se vuelve un modelo para todos nosotros. Creo que para hombres y mujeres que la sociedad ha quebrantado, ha roto. Creo que en español la palabra es roto. Y nada, creo que eso ayudaría muchísimo para estas generaciones, ¿no?
Dos preguntas en una, ¿verdad? Una definición y por qué el quebrantamiento es consecuencia del pecado.
I would want to add also, I think, listening to voices since morning, that one of the concerns that people seem to have with brokenness is a sense that we are maybe advocating a tolerance of that which is sinful in how we live. And I don't think that's where we are pitching the conversation. The conversation is understanding, or at least we're trying to put out a conversation around what the impact of the fall and the restoration that is necessary will take. the things that need to happen and how we as Christians live within that space. That we live vulnerable, we live in a sense in unprotected space because of what the fall has resulted in. That I think as Paul would say in Ephesians, it's critical for us to remember that we're not fighting against things we see. We are fighting against powers and principalities in the heavenly places, as the King James would say. Now, the thought of that is that for us to make it through that process, one, we need each other, because in each other invested the necessary gifts that we need to be able to make, you know, the way through. But also we approach it in that sense of understanding that we are inadequate, that we understand human limitation, but we also understand that human limitation can be broken, as we saw happen on Easter Monday, on Easter Sunday.
So it's hard to talk about brokenness as a consequence of sin because that's maybe not always what we mean by brokenness. Maybe we can do it this way. Intimacy with God seems to be the life that is being given to us. And so on the one hand, the further we step out of intimacy with God, the more degraded our life becomes. Now, we could describe that as brokenness. We could describe that as sinfulness, moving away from God, that space between us and God. What's fascinating, though, is that in order to deal with this, God steps into it by becoming flesh and by being broken. And then the brokenness of God becomes an invitation back to our healing. And so I hope that somehow engages the question, how is brokenness a consequence of sin? But I also hope you hear me saying at the same time, I don't think that we defeat sin by making ourselves just unified and whole. In other words, we do this through the way that God has engaged and overcome defeated sin, which is by being broken. And then the brokenness of God becomes the place in which we enter into the divine life and are made new.
El público, alguna pregunta, algún comentario. Allá.
Okay, I have just a little short comment. When we talk about brokenness of Christ, then it's mostly about his body. The body was broken, not his spirit. I mean, he's not sinful human being. But when we talk about people and about their brokenness, often it's mostly about that we are fallen creatures, right? And like, how can we still unite this brokenness of Christ, which is mostly about his body, physical body, which then after his resurrections became glorious body, and even if it's what's with the spots, it still was glorious body. And our brokenness, which is mostly the idea that we are fallen creature, it's somehow, in my mind, it's not really connected. It's like two different brokenness we're talking about.
Gracias.
Yeah, that's really helpful. And I think Brother Klaus's first sermon, the first day, is helpful here with Dietrich Bonhoeffer. And so for him, his brokenness was his oneness and solidarity with the Jews. It wasn't his personal limitations. It may have included those as well. But, you know, like Christ, his brokenness is his solidarity, his social and political commitment to us as a people and to representing us in death. And so I do want to speak more about perfection as brokenness and our solidarity with the suffering. And there's something about perfection there That's a different kind of brokenness than maybe, at least in the West, the modern focus on being anxious or broken and limited and so on. Not that those elements won't be included in some way.
I think when we think about the humanity of Christ, the full humanity of Christ, we can appreciate that his brokenness was not just in his body. There is a lot of brokenness that we can actually venture into and think through from the human side of what he experienced as rejection, abandonment, shame. Shame is a significant one, and the full weight of the feeling of those things and the willingness to take those on. To use a different example and to maybe bring the full Godhead into the picture is corporate lament. I hinted at it, but I think sometimes we may think of lament as just crying out to God, and we cry out in frustration, anger, all of those things, but maybe we switch to thinking of corporate lament, especially, as crying out with God, that God laments with us. We lament with God. We join in God in seeing the injustices, not just in our world, but the injustices in Israel, the injustices in the church that need to be met with some emotion, met with some anger and frustration, and that invite us into that very human yet still kind of broken response of in our inadequacy to know what to do, or in maybe God's grace to not always fix those situations, but to walk with us in relationship, we cry out because we don't know what else to do. And that'll just bring us into thinking about the corporate lamenting maybe we need to do in recognition of the brokenness within our institution and institutions. And how do we begin to work and wrestle with that?
¿Otra pregunta? ¿El público? Acá. Gracias.
So we talked a lot about having a social conscience and also about living in a community and a holy community and like that. How do you explain John Wesley? He was not able to keep up with his wife and they left. So can we put it, this could be a good example of brokenness, for example, we can consider it as a brokenness. So, yeah. Okay, so my name is Andrew from Lebanon, Beirut.
Okay, gracias, gracias. ¿Alguien más? Una segunda pregunta. ¿Cuál es la santidad comunitaria de una iglesia que no puede evitar? ¿Cuál es la santidad comunitaria de una iglesia que no puede evitar participar en sistemas de opresión, explotación y abandono? Muy buena pregunta. ¿Al panel?
Creo que El mero hecho de que nosotros tengamos un texto bíblico en nuestras manos es la presencia de una comunidad. Nuestra iglesia, muchas veces pensamos que es una iglesia local o una iglesia, gracias a Dios por la iglesia Nazareno, que es una iglesia mundial. Y hoy tenemos una iglesia mundial representada acá. Pero también tenemos una iglesia de 21 siglos que se levanta como un testimonio acompañándonos en nuestras experiencias.
Y todos estos hombres y estas mujeres sirven a la iglesia a mantenerse. Y podemos encontrar diversas experiencias, diversas historias como himnos que se levantan en sistemas de opresión, que se levantan para acompañar en la resistencia. Y creo que cosas como el gospel son hermosas notas de una iglesia que se mantuvo confesante en medio de una opresión. Y están ahí, acompañándonos. No creo que nadie de nosotros haya realmente llegado a creer solo. Siempre hay una comunidad ahí. Gracias.
The first few chapters of the book of Revelation are the letters to the churches. And if I could summarize them in a brief moment, I would say it like this. Here is the angel speaking to the church, stay faithful to the way of Jesus because that really is what's making the world new. Now you're going to see all kinds of other systems and all kinds of other structures working in the world, and they look really good and they look like they have a lot of power and a lot of stuff that they can get done. But the conviction that guides the church is that the crucified peasant from the wrong side of the tracks, Jesus of Nazareth, who is resurrected, is actually how God is making the world new. And that is the faith of the church. That really is the way that God's making the world new. And so when I hear questions about the communal holiness of a church that can't help but participate in systems of oppression, I can't help but hear revelation on my shoulder. Stay faithful to the way of Jesus. Here's part of my concern is that when we move further away from the slaughtered lamb on the throne, we move closer to systems of oppression. Or we do it sometimes in really good intent. But I am deeply concerned that the church stay faithful to the particular way of Jesus Christ, even if it costs us everything. And part of the conviction of Revelation is to say, look, stay faithful to the way of Jesus, even if it costs you everything. That really is the way that God is making all things new. I think there is an impulse in the church, especially in institutions, to say, to look around and say, oh my word, we are bleeding. We're dying. And the impulse becomes, let's suture the wound. Let's protect and preserve our institutional life. And so if there's any kind of wound in our body, if there's any kind of place where we are pouring out, make sure you protect that and don't allow that to end the life of the body. And I cannot help but hear the witness of the biblical writers saying, that's not the life of the church. The life of the church is to be in the likeness of Jesus and give yourself a way for the renewal of the world. I hear John saying that through the book of Revelation. That really is what's going to not only make the world new, but give the very life to the church. And so I go back to John 20, when Jesus is exhaling the Spirit on the church. I can't help but think of the fact that this is making the church, bringing the church to life in the likeness of the body of Christ, who has an open wound where his life was poured out. And I think that what is happening there is the Spirit is enlivening the church in the likeness of Jesus if we will allow the Spirit to do that work. But I am deeply concerned that we get closer to systems of oppression because we are so fearful that we are going to lose ourselves. Jesus doesn't seem to have that fear. The tighter we hold onto our life, the more we're going to lose it. And I think I hear the witness of the biblical writer saying, it's okay. You are being breathed to life by a Spirit and the resurrected Christ. What's going to happen to you? What's the worst that they can do to you? Take your life? The resurrected Christ is already resurrected. The Spirit is already blowing. It's already bringing you back to life. And I want to be sure we don't lose our life in an attempt to hold on to it, to cover the wound, to make sure that we're preserving ourselves. Because really, where we give ourselves away to follow in the likeness of Jesus is also where we invite other people in to the life. So when it comes to oppression and exploitation, neglect, I think we've just got to continue to stay faithful to the way of Jesus, have revelation on our shoulders saying, are we continuing to participate in the way of Jesus that really is making all things new? If not, where do we need to correct in this? In this time between the times, between the garden and the New Jerusalem, there is no way that we will just kind of extricate ourselves from all of the systems of oppression and sin. But the church can, by the power of the Spirit, be faithful to the way of Jesus if we will participate in that, if we will respond to that grace that's being given to us.
I would add also that I think there are parameters we can put in place to assist us walk along this journey of companionship with Christ in the fellowship of the Spirit. One of those things that I think becomes critical is understanding that we are on this journey of becoming until we come to, which is the time when we get into be reunited, you know, with God at the end of time. But in the meantime, we are works, we're a project that's still going on. God is still working in us. And sometimes we want to be before we go through the process of becoming. And what I think we're talking about when we talk about living in community and in companionship is how we allow ourselves to be part of this process of being shaped and molded. And if we do that and live together around the idea So if we do this around the idea of what I'm trying to develop as an idea, that we can live redemptively because we've been redeemed, which means we give others a slack, we give ourselves a slack because we've been given a slack in many ways. If we live that way, we cannot at the same time be perpetrators or be associated with oppression, because part of that redemptive living is making things better, knowing that the betterness of things is what takes us to the restoration of what we lost in the garden. And it is a work of grace. It is the Holy Spirit putting us together and allowing us. And when I talk about confessional living, it's not revealing all the secrets and the salacious things that we do when the sun falls. That's not what I'm talking about. It is about an open conversation about how we're feeling God, we're experiencing God, and how we see Him influencing and impacting all of us. But we need to do that in conversation with each other, because when we do that, I see God in a different light. I thought God was from my village, but when I talk to someone who is not from my village, I realize God is bigger than my village. Maybe I was missing something.
I'll take it a little further and say, in confession, let's be even more vulnerable, and let's institutionally start to really put things out there and actually have discussions about them that really challenge each other while not having to demonize one side or push someone out in order to deal with that. I mean, we can't, if we're a church that is committed to seeking holiness in its fullness, we have to be able to come vulnerably in confession and recognize that we don't have it perfect. And there are some things that need to be worked out. And until we start actually voicing them and giving voice to it and giving voice to those who have been pushed down, we can't hear each other and we can't move forward. And so to me, in safe spaces, And that kind of seems hard. You would think the church is a safe space, but it doesn't feel that way sometimes, institutionally. But in safe spaces, we should be able to speak very openly in a spirit of graciousness, yet seriousness about some of these issues, and begin to work through those without having to feel like, if I say this, if I say what I'm feeling, if I say what I'm thinking, I may be, they're going to pull my credentials. They're going to push me out of this church. And I'm not, and I know some of you may think I'm pointing to specific situations, but I'm not. I'm really speaking about there are too many times when we as the church don't want to hear our dirty laundry, and we need to hear it, and we need to address it, because in that imperfection and in that confession and in that humility, we can move forward in a very holistic way, or a more holistic way than we have. And so I appreciate, you know, are we willing to die to self and even die to the institution to be true to who we are and what our calling and mission is? And that's a hard question as an institution or as a larger denomination.
Say one more thing about this. Engaging systems of oppression, exploitation, and neglect is what Nazarenes do. And we have done this in the power of the Spirit for over a century. I think this is part of why God has called the Church of the Nazarene into existence. I don't think we need to be afraid of it. So as the church moves against systems of oppression, exploitation, and neglect, what I'm saying is that this is a pneumatology that gives us quite literally a spirit that doesn't have to be afraid of going up against these things. Again, to Revelation, you would think that the systems of oppression, exploitation, neglect would win over against the slaughtered lamb, and they don't. And so the question is whether we want to be resurrected to live in the power of the slaughtered lamb who brings down all the systems. If you read kind of Revelation, all those systems of power and exploitation, they go down into the lake of fire. The way of Jesus really is making everything new. Do we want to stay faithful to that way? And in terms of brokenness, we have a theology of brokenness and chairs. Yeah. Yeah.
Me viene a la mente Mateo capítulo 5, del 13 en adelante. Jesús habla de dos figuras para la iglesia. ¿Ser qué? Ser sal y luz. Pensando en ese contexto de la pregunta, algunos de nuestros países la iglesia vive en sistemas de opresión, explotación, abandono. Aún algunos de que habían sido invitados para participar no están aquí porque están en algunos de estos países, que es muy difícil poder encontrar una visa para venir. Y creo que el Señor no hace excepciones en Mateo 5 a estos países donde hay explotación, estos países donde hay abandono, estos no seas luz. Creo que es general, o me equivoco. Está abierta el tema para acá, para el auditorio. ¿Alguna pregunta, algún comentario sobre este tema? ¿Algún comentario? David, por favor, acá el micrófono. Ya te lo traigo.
Thank you very much. I am a little confused about the question because it says, what is the communal holiness of a church that cannot help but participate in systems of oppression, exploitation? In Spanish it says, no, que no puede evitar participar, cannot avoid to participate in systems of oppression. So the church cannot avoid to participate in this class, in this kind of systems. I think the church doesn't participate in these systems. No sé, like fighting with the idea, no? I am the church, I don't participate in this kind of churches. Jesus Christ, he lived in when the Roman Empire was governing, no, to the Jews. What he did about this? Well, I think the The mission of that church is to preach God's word, to make a transformation in their community. But the church participating in the system of oppression, I don't agree, or perhaps I don't understand. Thank you.
Gracias.
I think to some extent it's a statement of a reality, not a choice, hopefully, to participate in such oppression. But some of the realities in recognizing that in certain decisions we make, they have negative effects on others that we don't maybe think about. And that's some of the imperfection I'm talking about, the brokenness. So the one method is to make a decision, and when you recognize certain consequences that you weren't trying to have happen, to stand up and say, well, we did it with the right motivation, so it's okay. And to then just push forward and justify it as part of our mission, as part of our holiness. We did this. We did it with good intent. Well, I don't care if you did it with good intent if the outcome also has oppression on others. How do we then stop and say, well, wait a second, how do we pull back on that? Where can we have those moments of pulling back and saying, okay, things we didn't realize. We don't have to justify our actions. We have to talk through them and begin openly to work through them and listen well. And, you know, so that's where, you know, even the confession part where we talk about that, there's a lot of personal confession when I hear stories of, and I know, I hear stories of decisions I have made that unintendedly have had consequences on others that wasn't my purpose, and yet that doesn't free me for then having to go seek forgiveness and reconciliation and trying to right those situations. As difficult as that is, even though, again, I can say I'm very justified. I had the power to do it. I had the right motivation in doing it. And I didn't intend that, so I'm not responsible. So that's very different attitude and stance than a holy people I'm talking about here.
Allá, gracias. Una pregunta o comentario.
Thank you. Tim Hahn, USA Canada. So I teach at Northwest Nazarene University in Idaho, in the United States. Idaho is a state that is on land originally originally inhabited by indigenous peoples, the Kootenai and the Nez Perce, among others. There's no one still alive who made the original choice to displace those people, to implement the particular mechanisms of colonialism that created what is now the state of Idaho. And so I'm very appreciative of the comments that have been made about unintended consequences. And I agree, the church should not willfully participate in systems of oppression. But I'm wanting us to think, to ask a more difficult question. How can the church confess its own sanctification when it cannot escape these actions of colonizers centuries ago? When there's nobody alive that we can say this is their action, but the consequences of that action perpetuate harm, violence, oppression, things that the church should stand up and say, this is against God's desires. We would rightly call this sin. How do we think? I'm asking us to expand our conversation around brokenness to include things that transcend our knowledge and our will.
Gracias. Comentario.
Tim, go on. I don't know.
¿Alguien más?
So I can't write institutional policy for NNU right here. I can talk about what we're trying to do in a local setting where we are living in the wake of the sin of racism that has redlined the city of Nashville. Redlining, and it may not make sense in a global context. In the south of the U.S., there were red lines drawn on maps where white people could live and where black people could live. Kansas City, too. Yeah. So it's not just the south. Yeah, there's all kinds of other places in the U.S. where this has happened. We're still living in the wake of all of that. And so my kids ask lots of questions about why all of the other kids who come from the housing projects down the street only are black, and why is that the way that it is? And Tim, I'm not gonna have a satisfactory answer to your question. Congrats on a really difficult question, nailed it. But my hope is that we are leading the church to give itself away in the likeness of Jesus to say, whatever we are trying to hold on to, that will be the death of us if we can't give ourselves away to engage that kind of an oppressive system, if that makes sense. So we're going to do, like, in other words, I kind of want us to die on that hill because that's the way to life in the church through the Spirit. And there needs to be, I think, a constant examination in the life of the church to say, is there something that we are just holding onto institutionally so much so that we wouldn't be willing to go into that system and to allow the Spirit to breathe new life there? And if so, we've got to confess that. So that's not satisfactory, but this is just kind of where we are living as a congregation these days.
I would probably add two things. One maybe not so theological, but there's an idea, I think, in the wisdom of one of our communities in Africa that goes something like the best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago, and the next best time is now. It always reminds me that I can never be defeated by the past. Understanding it is essential for me to continue on the redemption journey. It gives me more reason why I should be part of this community and why I should be on this journey of redemption, because I come out of a history that is messy. And it shouldn't paralyze me that it is, but it should actually encourage me to be on this journey so that I can be part of making things better as we find a new identity. I think one of my fears, as I was saying in the morning, is when I look around us, I always see more community structures emerging, some of which are confusing, where people of faith become nationalists and become all kinds of things that stand in the way of being able to see a new world together. And when I see that, I get afraid at times because I see myself standing alone. And that's where I long and wish for a community of holiness people to put themselves out there as a model of a better world. It's pricey. There is a price to pay when you live redemptively. And I think that's where my passion is, that I can be part of that community and be vulnerable enough to make meaningful contribution of my time, of my resources, of the giftings that God has given me.
Hace algunos meses estaba leyendo a Michael Green sobre Romanos. Y él plantea en este libro el pecado en Romanos y lo plantea de tres formas. Primero, el pecado como un tirano, como un faraón cósmico que tiene atrapado a la humanidad y que este pecado incluso ocupa la ley como una pistola o un arma para matar al hombre. Pero también se ve, y es por los escritos de Pablo en Romanos, se ve al pecado como un sistema de opresión. Y aquí los latinoamericanos han hecho mucha literatura sobre eso. Y por último, se ve al pecado como un ente individual, que solamente afecta al individuo. Entonces, la propuesta de este autor es que nosotros deberíamos considerar que el pecado es muy complejo y que está representado en las tres cosas. Es algo que nosotros no podemos erradicar sin Cristo. Jesús viene y nos libera del faraón. Pero creo que Romanos 6, capítulo 7 y capítulo 8 representan este drama de la humanidad. Es un drama. Romanos 7, Pablo está hablando de que la ley no puede liberar al ser humano. Pero Romanos 8 dice, gracias a Cristo somos más que vencedores. Y este Espíritu Santo, que muchas veces vemos el Espíritu como sin cuerpo, algo que no es material, pero en la mentalidad hebrea el Espíritu es un huracán, es una fuerza, es un poder. Y lo que está haciendo Pablo es, aparece la ley del Espíritu en esta lucha de la humanidad. Y creo que si somos un pueblo del Espíritu, debemos ser guiados por este Espíritu. Y me gustaría citar a William Wilberforce, que fue un abogado inspirado por Wesley a luchar por la esclavitud transatlántica. Y trabajó 32 años hasta que la ley no solamente fuera aplicada, sino fuera vigente para todas las personas. Y creo que traer estas preguntas nos pone en el lugar correcto, porque nosotros pudiéramos estar hablando de iglecrecimiento y esas cosas que pueden ser buenas, pero necesitamos recuperar la conciencia sobre nuestras estructuras. Solo, gracias.
Vamos a la pregunta 3, vamos avanzando. ¿Cómo podemos dejar que el Espíritu Santo nos confronte dentro de la iglesia y como iglesia sobre las formas en que hemos causado quebrantamiento? ¿Sí? ¿Cómo podemos dejar que el Espíritu Santo nos confronte dentro de la iglesia, como iglesia, sobre las formas en que hemos causado quebrantamiento?
Bueno, voy a aprovechar que lo tengo. Hace unas semanas hicimos con un grupo de amigos una actividad de evangelismo. Y en la actividad que nosotros llevábamos, llevamos versículos bíblicos para regalar, pero antes le pedimos a la persona que ponga algo que está luchando esa persona dentro de ella, o un pensamiento, alguna historia. Y esa chica puso un papel, y cuando saca el versículo bíblico que llevamos para ella, ella se pone a llorar y empieza a llorar incansablemente. Y le preguntamos por qué lloraba, y ella estaba diciendo que esa noche previa había llorado toda la semana, todo ese día, perdón, toda esa noche le había llorado y le había preguntado a Dios. Ella no es cristiana, ella es una chica de la calle, o sea, la encontramos en la calle, no de la calle, estaba en la calle. Y nos dijo, toda la noche le pregunté a Dios si podía perdonarme. Y ahora este papel literalmente decía ese versículo, el perdón es un regalo de Dios. Y creo que cuando la iglesia es sensible al Espíritu, y yo pude entender y ver la gracia preveniente en la vida de esa chica, De hecho, le preguntamos por qué había agarrado ese papel, porque traíamos varios versículos y dice, algo dentro de mí me dijo que debía agarrar el papel rosa. Y lo agarró. Y creo que este es el espíritu. Creo que es una iglesia que debería de tener, no debería tener miedo de estar donde está el dolor, donde está el quebranto. Y el espíritu ya está obrando ahí. Y si somos wesleyanos, vamos a creer en esta gracia preliminar que está preparando los corazones de las personas para que la iglesia llegue y haga su trabajo.
I was thinking about the busyness of all of us. And I know all of us have stepped away from a lot of things, and it's even hard to detach. And the lack of space we give ourselves. I mean, even looking at the schedule, the lack of space we give ourselves to communally and individually listen to the Spirit. And that's what we need to do. And there's a struggle there because of how busy we are, and we don't make that a priority. I will say I don't always make it a priority. Can't speak for you. But even as a church, we don't always make it a priority. I'll quote Bonhoeffer again, or I'll paraphrase Bonhoeffer in his Life Together. We go alone, or we go to be alone for the church. So part of what acts of piety are for is so that when we move into community, our acts of mercy can be lived out in the power of the Spirit rather than in the strength that I have in and of myself. And so we need to be serious about those disciplines of being alone, prayer, meditation. Deanna mentioned some of these yesterday, and how serious we have to be about those spiritual formation aspects, but not for ourselves, I would argue, not for ourselves alone, but for the community. And where are those spaces that we are creating for that in our busyness and in all that we are doing? And that's a challenge, I think, for us to figure out. You know, maybe we need to have more silent retreats where we all come together and say very little and just listen and pray more.
Yeah, I'm still thinking about Tim's question and combining it with this one a bit. I wonder if the thought of kind of the finiteness of our own ability to fulfill God's will, to be holy, is still a helpful category. Because there's a sense in which, I mean, I'm overwhelmed by your question, and overwhelmed by the needs of the world and so on. Even thinking about our, at least in the West, our participation in various systems of injustice. And there's just no answer to it in some ways except for to confess our utter dependence upon God and our inability as finite beings to do everything. And so the whole of creation groans for redemption. And so maybe part of the openness we have to allow the Spirit to confront us is just a humble, receptive posture that there's a limitation to our action. I don't mean to use that as a concept to be complicit, but also to accept the finiteness of my ability to change the world. And maybe that very openness to the Spirit itself is a witness to the kind of creaturely holiness that recognizes that the fullness of the divine life is completely reliant upon God to fill our creation. So I often think about the Beatitudes, that blessed are the poor in spirit is the first one. And I think that's a kind of the fundamental posture of what it means to be Christian, is that we're fundamentally, as creatures, poor in being and utterly dependent upon God. And that posture should frame maybe some of our responses to these questions in the midst of their complexity.
Abrimos el tema al auditorio. ¿Algún comentario, alguna participación? Allá. Hermana Rocío.
While Stephen's moving, I'll simply also mention prayers of confession during our corporate worship gatherings. Wesley understood this as a means of sanctification. There are times when I know Nazarenes have struggled with this, like we don't have anything to confess. We're entirely sanctified. But let's remember that Wesley said this is an ongoing means of our dynamic sanctification. So having prayers of confession on our lips on a regular basis would probably help us with this.
Hermana Rocío.
En el libro de John Stott, La Iglesia en Tiempos Contemporáneos, el autor hace referencia que estamos en búsqueda de la trascendencia, del significado y de la comunidad. Por lo tanto, si estoy en búsqueda de la trascendencia, estoy buscando a Dios. Si estoy buscando significado, estoy buscándome a mí misma, mi identidad en el Señor. Y si estoy buscando una comunidad, estoy buscando esa comunidad de creyentes en constante interacción en amor. Pero tal parece que el problema somos realmente nosotros. Bueno, desde mi perspectiva muy particular, ¿verdad? Dice Paulo Freire que en el libro La Cultura del Oprimido, él dice que me concibo como mujer oprimida en el momento en que mi conciencia está totalmente sometida, pero que cuando nos damos cuenta de la realidad, nuestra conciencia empieza a emerger. Pero ¿qué pasa cuando mi conciencia emerge? Mi conciencia se torna en transitiva, ingenua. Nos damos cuenta de la realidad. ¿Por qué no emerge en su totalidad? Porque cuando me doy cuenta de lo que implica, mayor compromiso, mayor dedicación, entonces no queremos pagar el precio. Dice Juan Wesley, en un análisis que hace a la educación teológica, que solamente la verdad nos hará libres. Y para que realmente la verdad nos haga libres, si estoy dispuesta a aceptar esa verdad, entonces dice que la venda se va a caer de mis ojos y voy a ver la realidad tal cual es, y que solamente Cristo nos va a dar la libertad. El Padre, el Hijo y el Espíritu Santo. Pero en este análisis que hace Juan Wesley, nos lleva precisamente a pensar que el trabajo en comunidad es aceptar, respetar la diversidad de pensamiento y amar a mi prójimo en esa diversidad de temperamentos. Y me llama la atención lo que el hermano expuso al inicio, ¿verdad? ¿Qué lo motivó? La frustración. Posiblemente las iglesias, nuestras iglesias nos lleven a esa frustración, pero a pesar de eso, ama tu iglesia. Y Bonhoeffer dice en Vida en Comunidad, no te atrevas a juzgar a tu hermano. Y cuando se habla de quebrantamiento, se habla de mi imperfección. Entonces, ¿cómo me voy a atrever a juzgar a mi hermano si yo soy esa vasija en las manos del Señor que está siendo moldeada? Entonces, como cuerpo de Cristo, nosotros tenemos que apoyar a nuestros hermanos que están padeciendo, ¿verdad? Porque recordemos que aún en las iglesias seguimos padeciendo. Hace rato en los grupos pequeños yo ponía un ejemplo. a una de mis mentoreadas cuando me dice, me estoy muriendo por dentro. Si hubiera yo asumido una actitud legalista, le hubiera dicho, estás pecando. ¿Sí? Pero mi hermana no quería escuchar eso en ese momento, ella quería escuchar una palabra de aliento, un abrazo, vamos a orar y vamos a pedirle al Señor que te restaure. Entonces yo siento que dentro de nuestras iglesias esa imperfección la tenemos todos y dice Bonhoeffer, no te atrevas a juzgar a tu hermano. Y hay un sociólogo, Peter Berger, que dice, cuando hace un análisis a la iglesia local, dice, nuestras acciones en la iglesia local constantemente están crucificando a nuestro Señor Jesucristo. Pero dice, anímense, hay victoria, porque si tus acciones están crucificando a Jesucristo, la victoria se hace presente porque Cristo vuelve a resucitar.
Muchas gracias. Quiero ir a la última pregunta. El espacio ya se nos está acortando. Y los que me están ayudando con la presentación, la pregunta 6. ¿Sí? Creo que es la última que vamos a trabajar esta tarde. La pregunta 6 dice, ¿existe una manera de pensar sobre la santidad individual y la santidad corporativa que no crea una dicotomía? ¿Existe una manera de pensar sobre la santidad individual y la santidad corporativa que no cree una dicotomía? Hermanos del panel.
Yes. So I'll start with a confession. I, in this paper, was swinging the pendulum as far to one side as a corrective to what I have seen in especially the westernized church and to the detriment maybe of not highlighting the need for personal holiness, which I would still tie as a community thing. So yes, I think there is a way of talking about it where it's not a dichotomy. I think in our small group, part of what we had talked about and what came out was a reality of how much of the world thinks about community and the individual within community as opposed to maybe how the North American church has often thought about the individual first and then how they participate in a community rather than the other way around. I spoke about how it was in my time in Eswatini where I experienced the depth of a different way of looking at community that opened my eyes to the self-centeredness in my own perspectives and that challenged me to think differently. And so so that's what I was pressing against, I think. And so I think I need to apologize because I recognize that what I'm speaking to is often speaking to one group and another group has something to teach me and to teach us about what the individual within community truly looks like and how personal holiness as part of a community and as part of the body of Christ can look more holy and true.
Let me just echo what Jacob said in the earlier session. Locating holiness in Christ is really helpful in this. And so the dichotomy doesn't have to be there between the individual and the community. We are in Christ. Now, this, I was joking with him earlier, this is what Wesleyans do with Karl Barth's doctrine of election. That was way funnier than I thought this group would get. It's okay. It's good. Because Barth argues that we are elect in Christ, but it's because Christ is the elect that humanity is electing God. And so what Jacob did this morning is sanctify that. It was wonderful. And so I think that when we make that move, we can collapse that dichotomous relationship between individual and communal holiness.
Del público. Acá.
My name is Zakali. I think Dr. Bebe earlier on did mention and made reference to this, and I took a bit of that statement saying that being a part of a community is what gives an individual an identity. And I think this is a gift that maybe coming from where we are coming from in the African context, where I am because we are and we are because I am, that the dichotomy does not necessarily exist, because my identity comes from being a part of this community. I'm holy because we are together a holy people. And we were giving an example in our group discussion there that in a community where I come from, when they ask you to introduce yourself, they're not asking for your name, they're asking for what we call isiduko, which means your root, where you come from, who are you? So you explain your identity as who we are as a people, as a tribe, as a clan. And I think that's one of the gifts that if we are a global community, as a Church of the Nazarene, that we can learn from our different places of background and not only have the one perspective or one story that we are telling as a holy people. Thank you.
Gracias.
Eu gostaria de pensar junto, né, essa questão. Na verdade, eu já tinha, acho que não é para eu falar. Já falei muito, acho. Se tiver outro microfone, que esse aqui está falhando. Mas eu tinha solicitado a palavra anteriormente, porque hoje eu senti um pouco desconfortável durante as discussões, porque nós falamos de questões, primeiro, que não estão muito bem definidas. Questões, vou repetir. Questões. Questões que não estão muito bem definidas, as terminologias. Eu até faria uma observação aos meus irmãos, principalmente da América Latina e português, que não usássemos a palavra quebrantamento. Vai trazer muita confusão. E precisamos, enquanto igreja, descobrir, nesses contextos, que palavra que vamos usar. Porque naquilo que entendemos, essa palavra é aquilo que no inglês eles chamam o surrender. Isso que é quebrantamento para nós. Então precisamos achar na nossa linguagem uma outra terminologia. Eu aconselho a não usar essa. Não sei se vamos ter um pacto de pilar ou uma declaração de Buenos Aires 2024, seria bom para ficar muito claro essas coisas, mas essa é uma palavra que precisamos definir. E a minha observação quanto a isso é que hoje falamos muito de uma igreja que precisa aceitar a imperfeição, dá uma ideia de flexibilidade, de baixar um pouco o nível, de abrir um pouco mais a certas questões constrangedoras, para não sermos uma igreja opressora e sermos inclusiva. Eu acho que temos que continuar conversando, não vamos esgotar o assunto aqui, continuar conversando, uma igreja que eu quero discuti-la enquanto a sua ação. Nós somos uma igreja tocada pelo Espírito Santo para alcançar o oprimido, para, como Jesus disse, dá-lhes voz de comer. Mulher, chegou quebrada, entre aspas, mas vá e não peques mais. Então, é esses conceitos que eu quero que a gente seja enquanto igreja. Não uma igreja que peca, não uma igreja que confessa, não uma igreja que não é inclusiva, não uma igreja que é inflexível, mas uma igreja que... que é a resposta de Deus ao mundo. Esse é o meu pensamento. E a palavra que eu pedi para essa questão, desculpem se eu fui antes, é porque eu tinha pedido a palavra, então vou falar de uma vez. A essa questão, agora à tarde fiquei mais contente, porque de manhã eu entendi que nós estávamos quase que criando uma bipolaridade. E não existe, uma coisa depende da outra ou uma coisa leva a outra. O Senhor nos santifica, santificação inicial, seguimos para a inteira santificação. É uma jornada no individual, para o coletivo, não tem que ser uma ou outra, um anulando o outro, mas é um processo contínuo, no individual e no coletivo, isso que nos dá a identidade, como a nossa irmã falou aqui. Então, estou muito mais tranquilo de que nós não vamos excluir uma coisa ou outra. Nós, nisso, eu acho que estamos chegando a um bom entendimento. Eu agradeço e eu quero colocar uma satisfação quanto a essa temática que acabou de ser dita, mas uma preocupação quanto àquela que temos discutido o dia inteiro, e eu ainda não sinto que estamos saindo daqui seguros.
Hermano Ken? 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 Hermano Ken?
Ken Brower, it's just a quick comment. I'm wondering if we thought of the word personal rather than individual. Understanding the word personal as referring to people in a nexus of relationships. If we might, in Western thinking at least, get rid of some of that dichotomy between the individual and holiness, and corporate holiness.
There's no community without persons, no persons without community.
En Chiapas hay una comunidad que se llama Tojolabal. En Chiapas hay una comunidad que se llama Tojolabal y ellos ocupan una expresión, nostraidad, como una idea de nosotros, la primera persona del plural, un nosotros. Y cuando un joven, por ejemplo, se robó la moto en otro pueblo, una motocicleta, y lo agarran en la cárcel, este pueblo va y libera a ese joven de la cárcel, paga por la moto y lo traen a una reunión donde todo el pueblo tiene voz, los niños y los adultos, porque la comunidad ha entendido que no es el problema solamente del adolescente, sino de todos, y cada uno de ellos juntos lucha por salvar al otro. Y creo que deberíamos recuperar esta idea de la santidad como una nostreidad, ¿no? Donde cada individuo es parte de esta comunidad sin dejar de ser hombres y mujeres.
Gracias. Llegamos a la última parte. Llegamos a la última parte en estos últimos minutos. 3 minutos para cada uno de ustedes. Quiero ponerlo de esta forma. ¿Qué desea de sus escritos que este público recuerde, ¿sí?, de lo que ustedes han escrito? ¿Entienden? ¿Qué desean que se lleve este público del escrito que ustedes hicieron?
Thank you. I wish you'd allow me to then read my paper and then I'll say page 5, page 2. But here is the thing. Let's not be lost in the optics of what we're talking about when we're talking about community and living in community as Christians. I would be very happy for us to be continuing the conversation by looking at the principles. What are the principles embedded in the scriptures that we can build around to get to what it means to be community for us as Nazarenes today in the 21st century, wherever we are, so that we can really begin to work with that on the basis of those principles. And I think one of the key principles is that God fundamentally calls us to living in companionship with Him and with one another. And that means us becoming vulnerable in how we live, which means living in open conversations with those that we are working with, to ensure that we are all still on the same journey, but also to protect each other. I know I'm covered behind me, I'm covered on my side by those who are on the journey with me, because we confess it every time.
Rob?
I'll start with a thank you, because I think this has been, I think, not only hearing the response papers, but the questions, being in the small group, I think we've all grown in holiness through this. Even as we still can't fully define brokenness, and I don't want to, even as I want us to sit in some of that uncomfortableness for a little bit longer, I think we've grown in understanding each other, and it starts a conversation, and so I thank you for that. And I value that. At the same time, I want to keep pushing. I want to keep pushing us as a denomination to embrace the fullness of holiness in that sense, the wideness of it. You know, sometimes I feel like, you know, in our split for Catholicism, we decided Christ's crucifixion wasn't important, only the resurrection. And we want to live in the glory of the resurrection without also embracing the suffering of the cross and the humility of the incarnation. And how holiness, I would argue, requires those three tied intimately together, the incarnation, the crucifixion, and the resurrection, I want to be a part of, I want to be better, I want to grow in relationship with each other, I want to be a part of a denomination that is seeking to grow and to learn, and is willing to ask difficult questions and to hear from various voices, even if they don't hear like those voices, and to recognize the spiritual gift of teachability and being able to actually learn from those even you disagree with, and pull something out of that. You know, I never give up hope in who we can be, both universally as the church, but who we can be as the Church of the Nazarene. And so let us push towards that hope even as we go into tomorrow's session.
Eiko?
Well, this has been fun. The Spirit's drawing us into the fullness of God. And I think what we've witnessed today, and particularly in the small groups, which has been my favorite part, to see how different cultures and languages are engaging the conversation, is that holiness takes time and it takes place. And that's an inherent goodness, actually, that if we give it space and we give it time, we let language work itself out. It makes us holy in the process. It's a means of grace. And I think that, you know, reminds us that our doctrine and our teachings are alive and dramatic and creative. And that's actually a good thing that we should celebrate. And so I think we as a tradition should resist trying to package these things neatly. We should resist simple categories, because the fact is we can create those categories, but the moment they go to another language or place, they're already lost, because the language only bears meaning in its context and in its game and in its relationship to its place and community. And so all that to say is I hope we as a tradition can keep doing things like this, and in doing so, perform what it means to be holy beings who stand before a holy God.
Dean?
I would love it if we as a church are truly holy. And that sounds like it's just a platitude. I mean that we are holy because of the holiness of our Lord Jesus Christ, who was crucified and resurrected and sits on the throne and has breathed the Spirit to empower us for mission so that we can have not just self-will, but true theological courage to participate in new creation, to be agents of new creation. And that is going to take theological clarity and courage that I think is only going to come from the Spirit. One of the ways that I have seen that happen here is when we opened with communion. We ate and drank of the broken body and poured out blood of Jesus so that we might become, if you heard the liturgy, that we might become the body of Christ for the world. And that is, if there's anything I want to, people to take away from this, it is that we might take back to our churches that kind of theological clarity and courage. Jesus Christ was crucified, broken, and resurrected, and we can be too. That's holy. Jesus' brokenness was no barrier to his holiness. He was in complete communion with the Father through the power of the Spirit, even in his brokenness. And we have nothing to fear in following him, even to that point of the cross.
Mauricio.
Sí, me gustaría hacer una cita de Michael Lodal. Y él dice, la capacidad de dialogar está en el corazón de la imagen de Dios. Dios nos crea para tener conversaciones, para tener un diálogo continuo con las agitaciones de la existencia histórica. Y creo que valdría la pena levantar este diálogo con todos. Con las nuevas generaciones, con las personas que no se atreven a decir públicamente sus imperfecciones. Y valdría la pena recuperar mucho de lo que hoy está pasando entre nosotros. Este espacio comunitario, este diálogo, esta conversación. Y hace unos meses daba una clase de neumatología y les ponía la imagen celta de del Espíritu Santo, un ganso salvaje, un ganso que no se deja domesticar. Y creo que el Espíritu Santo nos está llevando como iglesia a lugares donde podamos tener conversaciones que ayuden a tenernos claridad, pero sobre todo a que realmente seamos el cuerpo de Cristo representado aquí en la tierra. Y como dice Pablo, y creo que con eso me quedo, somos las cartas abiertas, leídas por todos. Y hermanos, muchos de nuestros jóvenes, muchas de las personas de la iglesia, el único evangelio que van a leer son ustedes, somos nosotros. Dios los bendiga.
Muchas gracias. Voy a invitar a ponerse de pie a todos. Denme un minuto para orar y cerrar este tiempo. Gracias, Dios, por este momento, por este tema, Señor. Somos un pueblo santo. Gracias por lo que tú estás haciendo y seguirás haciendo, Señor, en la iglesia del Nazareno. Gracias por tus hijos, tus hijas, y por este pueblo que está aquí, que ha sido redimido. Gracias por este equipo, Señor, que ha formado este panel. Sus escritos que no han quedado acá, tienen que trascender, Señor. Gracias por todo. En el nombre de Jesús. Amén. Un aplauso, por favor, a este panel. Muchas gracias, hermano Claudio.
Thank you for listening to the Holiness Today podcast. If you enjoyed this production and wish to hear more, visit holinesstoday.org/podcast or find us on Spotify, Apple, and Google Podcasts.